Welcome again to another edition of SZ Consult. And this week I'm going to talk about the topic of steroids for schizophrenia. Most psychiatrists, most mental health clinicians, and many clinicians, regardless of specialty, recognize steroids for their potential ability to cause things like mania, depression, or psychosis. However, there are some reasons to think that there might be some uses in some cases. And this basically is the case for thinking about steroid use in schizophrenia treatment. First, we know that lots of signals or lots of pieces of data tell us that schizophrenia is associated with abnormal inflammation. We can see in many kinds of autoimmune disorders that psychosis or schizophrenia-like clinical presentation occurs. We also know that giving drugs which cause inflammation, at least giving them to animals, can cause schizophrenia-like symptoms or behaviors that are reminiscent of that. And we know that several kinds of anti-inflammatory drugs appear to reduce symptoms of schizophrenia or symptoms of psychosis in people with schizophrenia. So if we know that schizophrenia is maybe, at least part of schizophrenia, might be an inflammatory illness, and if we know that anti-inflammatory drugs, at least some of them, seem to have some benefit, then glucocorticoid steroids, popularly broadly known as steroids, might work. They're probably the best and broadest kinds of anti-inflammatory treatments known, widely used in medical practice for autoimmune disorders and other inflammatory conditions. So that's the rationale for asking this question and going over some of the evidence that I just went over. We know that many autoimmune diseases can present with a schizophrenia-like picture, with psychosis being either the initial symptom, the most prominent and most notable symptom, or in some cases, the only symptom for some period of time. We know that lots of drugs which are pro-inflammatory are also known to have psychosis as a side effect. And interestingly, some of these psychotogenic drugs, here what I'm referring to in particular is amphetamine. We know that amphetamines can activate microglia to cause them to release inflammatory cytokines and also to modify the microvasculature around the microglia. And as I said, anti-inflammatory drugs seem to reduce schizophrenia symptoms, at least in some studies. Here is a relatively recent 2019 meta-analysis looking at various drugs with an anti-inflammatory aspect to their pharmacodynamics, and the authors have estimated the effect size of published studies. So significant and ranging from small but significant to large in the case of N-acetylcysteine. So different strategies, different aspects or facets of inflammation, and a signal for efficacy. I was going to say consistent signal, but of course, there's always some negative findings in all of these studies, which to me emphasizes that schizophrenia is not a unitary illness and that inflammation by itself is not a monolithic process. There's a lot of different components to it. So this is the rationale for what about steroids? Steroids are fabulously effective anti-inflammatory drugs. They, across the board, primarily reduce gene expression for lots of inflammatory mediators. So they inhibit the release of, or they inhibit the genes that produce cytokines, chemokines, cell adhesion molecules, various enzymes that produce these pro-inflammatory signals and their receptors, and they're among the most widely and commonly prescribed drugs in medical practice and remain treatments of choice for the first approach to a lot of autoimmune diseases to get a foothold and reduce runaway inflammation. So highly effective drugs, but again, just because people are listening on YouTube, got to emphasize or reemphasize that they do have a significant side effect burden. But coming back to the rationale, why, you know, maybe they work. Why not look at them? And they have, for various reasons. I didn't actually get into some of the rationale other than it was kind of loose in the 1950s. I'm paraphrasing the rationale. We notice that there are some steroid signaling abnormalities or some adrenal gland dysfunction in people with schizophrenia-like illness. And so we decided to try to augment the adrenal function. That's the basic simplistic rationale from 1950s. To put it more plainly, there was evidence that adrenal glands might not be fully functional in some cases of schizophrenia. So the simplistic rationale from that day was to just give more of the product of adrenal glands. In other words, the adrenocortical steroids, or also known as glucocorticoids. And reading these papers, you realize that the diagnostic criteria from 1950 might not have much resemblance to diagnostic criteria today, and standards for evidence were also quite sparse. So suffice it to say that Cohn and colleagues were looking at treatment refractory or chronically ill people without good response to antipsychotic drugs and reporting some favorable success in some cases. Palatin then came around in mid-1950 and looked at 9 women with schizophrenic patterns. In reading these detailed case descriptions, it's really clear that a lot of these patients probably would be given a different diagnosis today, but they didn't give enough information for me to say what diagnosis they would have. Suffice it to say they had declining function with some psychosis in there. There may have been some cases of depression with psychosis, some cases with mania, and some cases I'm not sure about. Regardless, in 5 of 9 patients, the majority did get reported to have been made, quote, definitely worse. However, 3 of these 9 patients reportedly had some modest benefit, although not sustained and probably not something that would be worth continuing on cortisone for that length of time. But there was maybe a bit of a signal. Kim, as a solo author, did a study in 10 patients with, quote, chronic treatment-resistant schizophrenia. They were randomized to 5 patients on a steroid, triamcinolone, 5 with placebo. And again, the details were very sparse, but 2 of the 5 in the triamcinolone or the steroid group had some degree of improvement, which to my eye is notable because these are people who had been many years of treatment with and oftentimes high doses of antipsychotic drugs with no benefit. So maybe something there. And that really is between 1950 and 1960, that's the totality of evidence. And kudos to Nasib and colleagues for even attempting this. In 2021, they published a study, which they started, I think, in 2019, in which they intended to recruit people with well-characterized schizophrenia and to randomize them to steroid or to placebo. In this case, they chose the steroid prednisolone, which is actually a very commonly used anti-inflammatory steroid in medical practice today. And they describe substantial efforts to mitigate the potential risk of exacerbation of psychosis or mania or depression, because again, everybody knows about these as possible risks from steroids. And they also describe substantial efforts to try to recruit patients into the study. Despite these efforts, they said that they could not meet their enrollment targets and had to stop their study prematurely because it became obvious that they weren't going to succeed at enrolling the numbers that they had calculated that needed for a meaningful result. In their commentary, they mentioned specifically that the biggest hurdle to enrolling patients was the perception amongst either potential research subjects or the doctors that they were asking to help with referrals that the steroids might worsen the psychiatric symptoms. And interestingly, they didn't. And because these authors were very well aware of the potential risks, so they were doing a good job of trying to monitor for ordinary adverse events or serious ones. And they found that versus placebo, the prednisone group or the prednisolone group did not have higher rates of psychiatric adverse events, nor did they have higher rates of serious adverse events. In fact, serious adverse events or ordinary adverse events were approximately the same in both groups. So interestingly, and to me, actually notably, the expected 1 in 20 or 1 in 3 estimates vary as to how often psychiatric adverse effects occur. But the data suggests a significant portion of people will experience them. But in this study, nobody did. And that may be because they were very deliberate in choosing a modest dose of prednisolone, 40 milligrams a day, which the authors commented is typically well tolerated and effective at inflammation reduction. So although they didn't see any signs of worsening of schizophrenia symptoms or psychosis, they actually found that the prednisolone group had significant reduction of their psychosis rating scale scores. The placebo group also improved. So both groups significantly got better during the course of the study. The difference between the placebo group and the prednisolone group was negligible. So it wasn't statistically significantly different. The size of that improvement was about 20 points on the PANSS. So this was actually a very significant reduction of symptoms, again, in both groups. So this study, in addition to not, in the final analysis, having enough subjects to meet their statistical power criteria, They also were confounded by a relatively robust placebo response in the placebo group. So I don't know what to make of the study. I'm glad that they published it, incomplete as it was, and that's what we know in terms of studies of steroids deliberately used for therapeutic benefit in schizophrenia. Astute listeners may recall that there are some autoimmune diseases which can cause psychosis as a symptom. I called that in this slide autoimmune psychosis. As I said, psychosis might be the initial symptom, the most prominent symptom, or the only symptom for some period of time in people with autoimmune illness. And the question then, what portion of people with schizophrenia might have actually an autoimmune disease or an autoimmune psychosis at its core? Nobody really knows for sure, but this study comes out of Freiburg, and they suggest that it may be a significant number of people. So Andres and colleagues did 180 consecutively enrolled admissions to the psychiatric hospital. They did a lumbar puncture and they collected cerebrospinal fluid from each of these 180 patients that were being admitted. Let's walk through the numbers here. Elevated white blood cell in cerebrospinal fluid, 3.4%, 1 in 33 patients. Antibodies against cell surface or neuron surface proteins like NMDA receptor or glutamate decarboxylase, again, 1 in 33 or 3%. Antibodies against oncoproteins, cancer-related neuronal proteins, found in 3%. So 1 in 33 having that level of evidence for CNS inflammation. If you look for signs of increased antibody production within the CNS and other intrathecal antibody production markers, then you find that 1 in 14 or 7% of these patients were busy making antibodies in their cerebrospinal fluid to something. And if you look at serum, then 1 in 4 or 25% had antibodies against some thyroid protein. So this is a kind of high prevalence of autoimmune markers. And some might regard these numbers as unbelievably high, like it couldn't possibly be, you know, 1 in 14 people with schizophrenia are actively making antibodies against brain protein. And if you are listening to this and think that this is like unbelievably high, I would simply ask, what's your frame of reference? I would suggest that you think that 1 in 14 or 1 in 4 patients with schizophrenia making these autoantibodies seems high because nobody's measuring them. So if we as psychiatrists don't actively look for CSF markers of antibody production or don't proactively screen for thyroid antibodies, we'll just assume that they don't exist. And the literature that exists on this is pretty sparse. And these are findings that aren't disseminated or actively publicized. So the common conception would be then by default, these autoimmune illnesses are probably extremely rare. But again, I think that's an artifact of the fact that we don't aggressively look for these things on a routine basis. So the true number, I don't think anybody knows. But Andres, 180 consecutively screened individuals seems like a reasonable approach to trying to give an estimate. And if their methodology for analyzing or detecting these things is correct, then 1 in 30 to 1 in 4 might have some degree of autoimmunity present, which would, I don't think the upper field is prepared exactly to know what to do with that. So to be clear again, we tend to avoid thinking about using steroids for schizophrenia treatment, number one, because they're not approved for that. And number two, as you saw, there's not a lot of studies on that. And then number three, because everybody knows that they do come with a significant rate of psychiatric adverse effects. So we try to avoid them generally if we can. However, in diseases in which there is an autoimmune component that is creating or contributing to psychotic symptoms, then maybe these might be treatments of choice. Unfortunately, the state of research is so poorly developed that we have essentially no good data to know who should get, if anybody should get steroids, or if so, who exactly should get them. A handful of really difficult to read and difficult to interpret reports from the 50s and 60s suggest that maybe some people might get a little bit better. The most recent study published in 21 suggests, interestingly, that very few people would get worse, maybe, but that study is compounded by low enrollment, and the degree to which people might get benefit is an open question because of the premature termination of the study and because of the relatively high placebo response in the placebo group. This would be, in my view, a very fruitful area to further explore, but given the pervasive and somewhat correct assessment of steroids as potentially very risky drugs with respect to psychosis, I think doing additional studies is going to be really, really difficult, though one would hope that if such studies were to be envisioned, that they might try to screen people based upon the presence of inflammatory biomarkers or various kinds of autoimmune proteins, and then stratify the sample according to those biomarkers and then run them against placebo, which also then finally, as a just parenthetical comment, brings up this interesting conundrum about psychiatry, because if one were to develop this kind of study, say, you know, get a large number of people that look like they have schizophrenia and systematically screen them for anti-thyroid antibodies or anti-neuronal antibodies or for other biomarkers of inflammation, then that would lead to a good number of people in that, you know, the people that have the autoimmune antibodies detected, they would get re-diagnosed. They would be called autoimmune encephalitis and therefore debatably excluded from the study. So the conundrum with psychiatry is that once we discover a quote unquote organic cause of a disease, then that disease ceases to become a psychiatric illness and all we're left with is the very idiopathic ones. But I personally would put some money on the idea that if we were to stratify a sample based upon biomarkers of inflammation, you might get a signal for steroids or other anti-inflammatory treatments as potentially useful. And as you know, expanding our ability to correctly diagnose and expanding our treatment options would be a very good thing at this stage in knowledge.